finished pretty much with 10 weeks of integration. And you notice no clickers today because I had an issue with the laptop, so I can't do it today. Midterm is 2 weeks from tomorrow night. It will cover stuff that we haven't done yet. It'll cover through section 6.3, which we will definitely get to before the midterm. Can you hear me okay? Guys, what else? If you're having, I've been receiving increasing emails about, this is hard, I can't do it. If you can't do it, this is why we have office hours. There's a lot of help available. So the Math Learning Center is open quite a number of hours. It tends to be open something like 10 to 8, Monday through Thursday, and then also Fridays until about 3. The drawback of the Math Learning Center is it's drop-in, and so you get who you get, and sometimes you have to fight for help. There are, I think, 8 of us associated with this course. Each of us have 3 office hours. So that makes 24 office hours. A number of them are in the Math Learning Center, but there's still quite a few that you can use. And you can also make appointments outside of office hours. I've seen exactly 2 people so far in this course for office hours. That's pretty bad out of 340. There's not 340 in this room, but still. You know, I don't mind if you don't come. I've got stuff to do, but I'm there in case you have questions. Anything else? I don't know. Any questions or issues people are having? Does that go along with academics? What does that mean? Like if you're having problems with other stuff? You're having problems with the material? Sure. Well, then you should ask. Okay, great. Yeah. Yay! Okay. Sorry. Go ahead. So the partial fractions and... Okay. I don't want to say your questions are, I don't care. But, I mean, I can go over 1 more partial fractions, but I've sort of gone over that. So I would recommend that what you do if you're having problems with partial fractions and integration by parts, just come see me after. And we'll go over it together. Just, you know, I kind of said all I feel like saying. If you have a specific question about partial fractions or integration by parts, I can address it. But, okay. You have one? It's the whole idea. Okay, so then definitely that's an office hour kind of thing. Other questions or issues people are having? I guess not, because I just asked and I shot it down. So I suck. Okay, so let's move on. So I want to point out a few things. We've covered all of the basic techniques, in fact, less than basic, all of the techniques of integration. You know, there's some special tricks that you can use hyperbolic signs and things like that. But for the most part, that's it. You should be able to do pretty much, probably more integrals than I can do, because I'm actually not very good at doing integrals. There are a lot of, and I was going to show it, but I don't have the laptop, there are computer programs that can integrate better than anybody. So there's a program called Maple, which you can download from software. You have a site license for it by virtue of being a student here. There's a program called Mathematica, same thing. There's a free program called Octave. There are a number of programs where you just type in the integral and you, in it, you know, in syntax like int x cubed x, and it says the answer is 1/3. No, it doesn't. it says the answer is 1/4 x to the 4th. So it just does the integral for you. So there are programs that will do this stuff for you, probably better than either you or I can do. They do a whole lot more than just that. Because integration is just a very mechanical process. There's a bunch of techniques, you mess around with it, out comes the answer. Same thing with derivatives and so on. But there's a lot of things. So how would you do this integral? Any clue?
Parts.
Try parts. I would try parts too. It won't work. Then what? Whatever you try, it won't work. So this integral, or this integral, or let me get another one that doesn't have an E in it. About that one. Well, this one sort of has an E in it. This integral, or give one with a sign. Sign it so we're not sure. This integral, or this integral. None of these integrals, and hundreds of others, thousands, infinitely many others, none of these integrals have nice formula to express what they are. But they are well-defined functions. They make sense. They are real things. They represent actual quantities. So there's an area underneath the curves involved in all of these things. And so there's an integral here. But we just don't have the symbols to represent it. Now, sometimes if you need to use this, people will make up formulas. I think this one has, you know, the special name SI. This one I know for sure is something. I think there's a 2 pi here. And maybe we make it maybe. Something like that. I always forget exactly how it goes. There's this thing called the error function. This guy, forget about this name. This integral, let's look at that integral. So if I graph this, it's a familiar thing. Does anybody know what the graph of this looks like? There's a negative here that I keep using. Does anyone know what the graph of this looks like?
Bell curve.
Yes. So this is a bell curve. Looks like that, and it comes up all the time. And so this integral, integral of e to the negative x squared dx, maybe with a 2 pi and maybe with a half in there and stuff like that, shows up all the time, especially in statistics. If we want to know how much area there is between here and here, this tells us something about the probability of a normally distributed event occurring. This tells us the expected height of people or the expected grade on a big exam or something like that. All of these things. So this is something important that we need to be able to do. But we have no formula for it except calling it ERF or something like that. To tabulate the values. So how does that work? The way that works is we remember that the integral of a function is, in fact, the limit as the number of things go to infinity adding up. With, let me just call it delta x. So this stuff that we did at the start of the class, that this is add up lots of skinny rectangles. And so you can write a computer program to estimate this pretty easily. You can calculate this to whatever precision you want. If I want to know what is the integral from 0 to 1 half of e to the minus x squared dx, this is a number. I don't know what it is off the top of my head, but I can calculate it to any precision I want. So I can calculate this to 1,000 digits if you want. And so what I want to talk about mostly today, it's not a hard topic, but it's something we need to cover, is how to do this, because this comes up a lot of times in applications, and some words get thrown around that maybe you've heard before, like Simpson's rule. How many people have heard of Simpson's rule? A couple. How many people have not heard of Simpson's rule? Most. Okay. So like Simpson's rule, or trapezoid method, or midpoint method, or things like that. These are numerical methods for approximating integrals that enable you to do this. And you should have some understanding of what they are, even though you probably will never write the computer code yourself. You'll just ask the computer to do it, and it'll use the numerical method to have an idea of what's going on behind the scenes. Do you know what works, and what doesn't work, and why it doesn't work? Okay, so the general idea here is we have our function, and we just draw my usual unknown function, and I want to calculate this area. So what we did in the beginning is we just take a bunch of rectangles, and here I'm putting them on the left side. So I can just take a bunch of rectangles. I have too many here already. Like that. And in this case, I chose the rectangle so that they all sit on what I just call the left side, but it's, well, this is the left side. So if we just add up the area of these rectangles, this gives us the left approximation. This is with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 rectangles. And that's, you can figure out, I think, pretty easily what that formula is. So that's one. Let me not do that because it's easy. Another thing I could do is I can make the right approximation. Let me just draw the same function, which would be slightly different here. I'm using guys on the right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So here's the right approximation. And again, it's pretty straightforward to figure out the formula. Here, if there are six guys, and I'm going from, let's say, 0 to 3, then the first one, since I'm going from 0 to 3, then if I have 6, each one is going to be 1 half wide, and so this would be 1 half, 1, 1 and a half, 2, 2 and a half, 3, and so on. I'll do an explicit example in just a sec. So those are two pretty obvious things that you can do. Much harder is to try and use the lower approximation. So we won't do this, but you should know it exists. The lower approximation, is going to fit my rectangle underneath at every time. So sometimes I'll use the right, sometimes I'll use the left, sometimes I'll use the middle. And then there's an upper approximation where I fit my rectangles over. I'm not going to talk about these. These are hard because you have hard work to find the points. And usually you don't know the function well enough to find the points anyway. So when will the lower approximation be the same as, let's say, the left approximation? That?
slope's always positive. Okay, so if the function is increasing, then the lower will be the same as the left. And if the function is decreasing, the lower will be the same as the right. And if the function has a max or a min, then the lower will be mixed. And the same about the other, I mean reversal to the other. Okay, so that's pretty straightforward. And rather than writing down a formula for this, because we already did these left approximations and right approximations in the first week of classes, let's talk about some slightly better ones. So the problem with using this method is I might have to use a lot of points. Right? If I'm using n points, if I want to get good accuracy, I might have to use a whole lot of points. So there are some ways we can improve the accuracy. And so what is one, can anyone suggest what might be a better way to get a better, typically better, accuracy without using more points? Okay, I don't know whether you're just like tired. He's the only guy who's awake. Yeah? So what does that mean? Okay, so one suggestion is crap is what? Which means if I have this function, here it is, and I have my six rectangles, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, well, it's not the same anymore, then instead of using rectangles, let the slopes on the tops, I don't know if you can see them, maybe I should make it curvier, just connect the dots. So here, I just connect the dots between the points. Now how can I write a formula? What is the area of the trapezoid? Yeah. Well, I guess if you're laying on the side, okay. The way I drew it here, the base is the same. So it's really the average of the two heights times the base, right? So the area of something that looks like this, if this is my, well, let's just call this delta x for my base. Actually, let's call this x1 and x2, these two points. So in this case, get the area of this thing, then the base is just x2 minus x1, and the height, this height, is f of x1, and this height is f of x2. And one way you can remember this is it's the same as the area of the rectangle if I cut this part off and clump it over there. Then I get a rectangle. I cut the top off and fold it over. Then I get a rectangle of exactly the average height. It's not in the middle necessarily. The thing is very steep. But anyway, I guess it is for there. So the area in this case is going to be the average of the heights. Times the base. Now, suppose I've already calculated the left and the right approximation. What does that tell me the trapezoid approximation is? It's just the average. Right? Because the left guys are all of the heights on this side, and the right guys are all the heights on that side. is the heights. So these two things, this guy is just the average of those two things. But let's write a formula for the trapezoid. So suppose I'm going to use n rectangles, so I want to integrate from a to b, f of x, dx. Now, I don't recommend that you memorize these formulas, because you'll forget them if you memorize them. Just draw the picture and look at the picture and figure it out. It only takes a minute if you know what's going on. So what we have to do here, well, the base is in everything, right? So we're just going to multiply by the base. So at every stage, I'm going to multiply by the width of my rectangle. So that's the width of each one of those rectangles. And now I just have to worry about the heights. So let's worry about the heights. Well, let's look at the whole picture rather than just one picture. How many right sides am I going to, or left sides am I going to get? Well, I'm going to get one from this rectangle, one from this rectangle, one from this one, one from this one, one from this one, one from this one. I'm not going to get the left. So I'm going to get n. One, two, three, four, five, six. Yeah, I'm going to get n left sides and n right sides. So I'm going to get f of x0, this is the left side of number 1. And then I'm going to get f of x1, this is the left of number 2. And then I'm going to get f of x2, f of x3. And then I'm going to stop at 1 before the last. This is the left side of number n. The last red thing. This is a big parenthesis. It's going to carry on the next one. And now I need to add in the right sides. Well, the first one here, I don't use this but once. I only call this the right left side once. The second one, then I get the right side here, and 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 the right side there. So I get n right sides, but I don't get this one, but one time. So this is the right side of number 1. Oops, that's a wrong. And then f of x2, f of x3. And this left side of the last guy is also the right side of the next to the last guy, but then I get one more. And I have to average, so I'll take half. So let me write that a little cleaner. Notice that here I get 2, here I get 2, everybody I get 2, except the first and the last. So with n rectangles, this is going to be 1 half b minus a over n. And I'm going to use, let me not use something. So then, it's the first guy plus twice the second guy plus twice the third guy plus twice the next guy, blah, 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 plus twice the penultimate guy plus the last guy. Right? So that's a pretty easy formula. It's just, so if I'm using n rectangles, that means I'm going to have n plus 1 points. So if I'm using 5 rectangles, I'll have 6 points. Because I have edges, we've got something in half, we actually have 3 n's. Right? The left side, right side. And I count everything double except for the 2 n's. And then I average that, and so I need 1 half b minus a over. So this is a pretty straightforward formula, pretty easy to do. You an example of an actual function? Here, f of x n. It's just the function at the very last point. So let me do, just to make it obvious, I'll do it with a very simple function. Let's just do x squared, because then I can do the numbers in my head. So let's, I mean, this is a stupid example, because we can figure out this exactly, so why do it approximately? The reason we're doing it approximately is because everything's easy. We would never do this for real, but let's do it for real anyway. So let's integrate from, let's start at 1 rather than 0. Let me use 4 points. Let me get that 4 intervals. So let's integrate from 1 to 2. X squared dx with 4 squared. Okay, so this is a really stupid example. That means I'm going to have 5 points I need to check at. Maybe I should go from 1 to 3. Let's go from 1 to 3. But I only have half. Okay, and I'm going to use the trapezoid method. So this would be T4 is the usual notation. And this is going to be 1 half, the width of the whole interval is 3 minus 1 is 2, but I'm doing 4 rectangles, so it's another half. We write it as 3 minus 1 over 4, so that's half. And then the points that I'm doing it on, let me draw the picture, I guess. I'm starting here at 1, and I'm doing 4 rectangles. I'm going out to 3, so 2's in the middle, and 1.5, and 2.5, my function is making that. So those are my trapezoids that I'm doing. And so I just compute f of 1, so that's 1 squared, plus twice f of 2, that's 3 halves squared, plus twice f of 2, which is 2 squared, plus twice 5 halves squared, plus, now the last guy only gets in once, so that's 3 squared. So this is 1/2 times 1/2 times 1 plus that's 9 over 4 times 2, 9 halves. And this is 4 times 2, that's 8. And this is 25 over 4 times 2, so that's 25 over 2. And that's 9. Which is some number. I don't know. 18 plus 17 is 35, so this is 35 over 4. Right there. I'm not sure, because I don't think it's 35. Well, I get 35 over 4 for this. Yeah. I have 1, 2, 3, 4 rectangles. I started at 1. So I didn't use the stuff before 1. So I started at 1. Well, I started at 1. It's the integral from 1 to 3. Wouldn't it be over 2? Is that what somebody said? Wait. Somebody made a comment about over 2. Okay. So change your mind. So now I don't have to find you. Okay. So this is pretty easy. It's just a matter of thinking about what you're doing and writing down what you're doing. The correct answer, of course, is x cubed over 3 evaluated from 1 to 3 is 27 over 3 minus 3rd is 26 over 3, which is some number. I don't even know what that means. So no. It's like 8 2/3, and that's like 8 3/4. So it's actually not so bad, right? 8 3/4. The exact answer is 8 3/4. So with 4 rectangles, I can sort of get ballpark. With 400 rectangles, I can get really close. Let me not do the example, but another thing we could do here instead of doing trapezoids. Another thing we can do here instead of doing trapezoids, and we can get kind of the same amount of work, is to take the midpoint. Same picture. So actually, let me just do it. So I'm doing the same integral. Here for midpoints, what do I have? Same score. So then think about the picture. I'm going from here to here. 1 to 3, and then chop it into 4 bits. I have 4 midpoints. The numbers are a little ookier because I have these same intervals, 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5. And the points that I want are the middles of those points. So I can also, I'm not going to do it all out. So again, it will be 2/4. That's the width of the rectangle. Is each of them is 1.5. So it's 1 to 3. I have 4 of them. Times. And now I want to do the function evaluated here at the first middle. So the first middle is halfway between 1 3/2, which is 1.25. 1 1/4. And then the next one will be at halfway between 1 1/4, I mean between 1.5 and 2, which is 1 3/4. And then the next one will be halfway between 2 and 2.5. So that'll be a 2.25. And then the last one will be between 2.5 and 3, so that's 2.75. So I square up all of those numbers, and I divide by 1/2, and that gives me my midpoint approximation. Also, pretty easy. Now, with a lot of work that we will not do in this class, you can actually get a bound on how far off these are, even if you don't know the right answer. If you have no way of knowing how good your estimate is, then this is kind of useless. But if I can tell you, if you ask me, how much money do you have? $100 million! That's my estimate! Well, I don't know, maybe I'm only off by 999,999,000. That tells you like nothing. Maybe I only have $1. That's an estimate, but it's a useless one because the error is so big. We have no way of knowing what the error is when the estimate is useless. So we can, not in this class, but in a numerical analysis class, or if you really want to work hard, we can figure out what the error is in these cases. So, what's this going to depend on? Does anybody have an idea of what this is going to... I mean, what will contribute to the arrow. How many rectangles? That's certainly a critical factor. And then another factor is sort of how wiggling functions. The derivative and the second derivative and the fourth derivative. So, and of course I forgot. So here, so if the second derivative is less than an absolute value somewhere in A, between the start and the end, so if we know the second derivative, the biggest the second derivative is, because the second derivative tells us how much this function bends. The second derivative, if there's some number k, so the second derivative is no bigger than that in absolute value, then the trapezoid approximation minus the actual value is going to be less than, and I always forget what we divide by here, so look. Chop it up into, so it depends on the interval a little bit, and it goes like the square of the number of intervals I take. So that means that if in this case, so here I was off by about a quarter, a little less than a quarter. If I went if I doubled the number of rectangles, then I should increase my answer. My answer should get better by a factor of 4. Because I'm going from 4 squared to 8 squared. So if I increase my thing if I double it, the number of rectangles, my answer gets better by a factor of 4. The midpoint is kind of the same. If the second derivative is bounded by k on the interval, then the midpoint approximation is, I didn't leave enough room, did I? Less than or equal to the same constant e minus a cubed, but here it's 24 in the interval. So the midpoint is a little better, but it doesn't really buy you much. The error in the midpoint is about half of what the error in the trapezoid rule is, but increasing n is way better. Yeah. K is the same k. It's bound on the second derivative. The second derivative is less than k on the whole interval. K depends on the function. So in this case, the second derivative, well, x is, the derivative of x is 2x. The derivative of 2x is 2. So in this case, k is 2. If I'm doing a sine, then the derivative is the second derivative of the sine, which is again the sine. It's never bigger than 1. And that's the value. But if I'm doing a very bendy function, if I'm doing e to the x, the second derivative is equal to e to the x. So depending on how bendy the function is, controls how good these approximations are. Second derivative. So if I have a function, and And that makes some amount of sense, because if my function goes like this, on top of my rectangle, the second derivative is very big on top of my rectangle, so my rectangle is going to be a terrible approximation. Okay, so in the remainder, I want to talk about something that's even better, and I want to give an example with deciding how many cans you need. So Simpson's rule, which I'm not going to have time to derive, you can read it if you want. So Simpson's rule is way better than both of these, because what it does is, you can draw one rectangle. So here's my function. And here's my rectangle, which I'm drawing very big. Instead of just looking at the middle or at the two ends, it uses all three of those, and it puts a parabola here. So instead of using a straight line like the trapezoid, or sort of an average rectangle like the midpoint rule, is it puts a parabola through the three points that go through the two ends in the middle. So that means that, I mean, you almost can't even see the difference in most cases. It's very hard for me to draw a function, unless it's a horrible wiggly thing, that doesn't look a lot like a parabola on a small piece. Right? It isn't a parabola. The vertex doesn't have to be in the middle. The vertex, in this case, is over here. So it's whatever parabola goes through those three points. So just like you know that two points determine a line, three points determine a parabola. And I don't have time to go through all the algebra, and you'll all fall asleep anyway. It is in the book if you want to read it. But it turns out that this is just a kind of a special average between the trapezoid and the midpoint. The pattern is 1, 4, 2, 4, 2, 4, 2, 1. So what does that mean? So if we look at this, then now we think about, let me put some more rectangles here with parabolas on them. So every time, notice that edges, well, this one gets counted once, because he counts only for the beginning rectangle. And this guy gets counted twice, because he counts from this side and from this side. And this guy gets counted twice. And so on. And the last guy gets only counted once. And then it turns out, by doing the calculation, that the middles each get counted four times. So, let me write this. And, well, okay. So the middles get counted four times, and then we have to average. I think we divide by three. Let's forget whether it's three or six. Depends on how what you call middle. I like to divide by six. So if this width is my base, I divide by 6. So let me write out the formula. Ow, bang. Sorry. So that means it's just about not right. Let me write away. Is just about. So here I'm going to use. So, okay, there's a little issue of terminology. In this picture, should I say that n is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6? Or should I say that n is 3? Well, it depends on what picture you're thinking of. Here I'm thinking of three rectangles. Three rectangles, I have 7 points I have to play. The book calls this six. So, what else? So let's call this N. Let's call it 2N. No. Let's call it N. So, let's just call it N. Let's call it N. Which means that I'm using half N intervals. So there's a little issue of what you want to call N. How many parabolas you're fitting, or how many points you're using. The way the book uses it is they call it N is the number of points, and I tend to prefer to call it the number of intervals. So let's do N to be the same as in the book, the number of points. So there's a homework problem that you don't have yet, and it is both. Okay, so if N, so it's N plus 1 points, which is N over 2 intervals. So that means that this little width here is B minus A over N. That's the half width, right? And instead of doing an average with a half, kind of because I have 3 points, I do an average with a third. But then the averaging I do is kind of funny. I take the first point once, then I take 4 times the second point, x1, that's a middle. Then I take twice of the third point, which is x2. And then I take 4 times of the next point. And then I take twice of the next point, and so on. And I do this until I'm almost done. And then at the end, I take 4 of the last midpoint and just 1. Very well. Okay, so this is kind of a funny average. It's a weighted sum. The middle counts more than the edges. The middle counts double the edges. So the pattern is 1, 4, 2, 4, 2, 4, 2, 4, 2, 4, 1. And if you do the little calculation, which I'm not going to do, you can see that this actually finds you the very best parabola. This 2 comes because I'm counting this point twice because it's 4. So let me, yeah. I have 3 points that I'm averaging instead of the other two. So instead of being a half, it's a third. But it's a funny average because I'm weighting them. I better have gotten this right.
Yes.
So let me do x squared again. Just a quick, I don't know. So n has to be even. I'll do n equals 4. Well, n equals 4 isn't enough to see the pattern because the last one would be. Well, maybe it is. So let me do x squared with n equals 4. It doesn't matter. So I'm going to do this again the same 1 to 3 dx with n equals 4. By Simpson's rule, so this would be 1/3 times the width b minus a over 2 times, and then here I want to do 1 squared plus 4 times four times 3/2 squared plus 2 times 2 squared plus 4 times 5/2 squared. Wait a minute, I'm going to 3? Yes. Plus 3 squared. So that's what Simpson's, what I would do on Simpson's rule. Again, notice the pattern 1, 4, 2, 4, 1. Now the error here, which is the whole use of Simpson's method, Simpson's rule, and I guess I'll have to finish this next time. But the error here is instead of saying, let's let M, so I need another number, so I need, and I'm pretty sure it's the fourth derivative, sorry, the fourth derivative. So there's some number that the fourth derivative is less than m on the whole thing. Then the error of Simpson's method is going to be less than. Simpson's method, right? Minus the integral. Is going to be less than m over n over squared. So this has to be the fourth. And I think this is 120. Let me check that. So. The important thing about Simpson's rule is that the error goes down like n to the fourth. So doing a little more work gives you a huge increase. So don't memorize these formulas. You can memorize the patterns. I will not ask you to memorize these error formulas on these things. You may ask you to use them. I won't ask you to memorize them. So, I will give one more example of this to start the next class and then move on to the next.